Hello and welcome to another episode of A Fresh Perspective here on Heavenward Thinking. Last week we started Luke chapter 8, starting in verse 26, and we talked about Jesus restoring a demon-possessed man. We did the first half of it. This week we're going to conclude it. We're going to be starting in verse 34 and going through verse 39. So I'll read it and we'll get right into today's conversation. When those tending the pig saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and countryside, and the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return home and tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. So last week we started this story, and now we get to see the conclusion, the happy ending, but it's not all happy in the second section. What do we see here with the response of these townspeople?
I think that this is what we need to grasp this. People are either drawn to Jesus or they're, you know, they want to go away from Jesus, mm-hmm. right? It's either one or the other. You're drawn, you repel. It's a magnet, right? Mm-hmm. And again, you would think that if a demonically possessed man who had to be in chains and could break chains, right? Mm. No clothes, no housing, right? All of a sudden became sane in his right mind, healed, right? You would think that people would be drawn to that, that they would bring any sickness they had, they'd bring any disease they had, which had been happening all over the place, right? People were bringing the sick, bringing all those who needed healing, right, to Jesus. Here, you see completely the opposite. They're repelled. They go away, right? It's, we don't want anything to do with you, right? Mm. We're fearful about this, right? Now, again, part of the problem is that probably this guy isn't the only one that's demonically possessed or oppressed, right? So you probably have an entire village of people that are have been oppressed in nature. Again, what happens? Fear comes upon us as a result, right, of the enemy. The enemy is about fear. Jesus said, fear not, right? Jesus said, right, that perfect love casts out all fear, right? So again, we're not supposed to have fear. Now, I don't have that down. Maybe you do, right? But we're supposed to not have fear. So you know that this is from the enemy. This is not a normal response, right? This is an area that seemingly is a pretty big stronghold for the enemy.
Absolutely. Yeah, I love how you pointed out the whole aspect of fear and the fact that this is totally not a normal response. So many times when we read this section, we're puzzled about it. How could these people who just are hearing about and seeing the results of some miraculous event, how could they respond this way? I mean, Jesus had cured this man who, by all recollection and collection here in the story, would have been a problem for these people, that he was so dangerous, he had to be out by himself, he had to be chained, but he broke his chains, like you mentioned, and so you would think they would be relieved and they would be thanking Jesus and they would want to be with Jesus, but instead they come out, they're terrified, and they ask Jesus to leave them, and we look at that and we go, that is crazy, we would never do something like that, but how many times do we respond instead of going to Jesus, instead of responding to his works in our lives, we respond, instead of in a good way, we respond in a negative way and ask him to leave. We don't really want him inconveniencing us. He terrifies us with his power. He's going to ask us to do something we don't want to do, and we quickly ask him to leave. We don't really want him working in our lives personally. That's great if he works in the person next to me, but as long as it's not me, I don't want to have to deal with it myself. And so we see that that's certainly the response of these people. How can we avoid that, knowing that we can fall into that same trap?
Well, I think number one, we need to understand that if the Holy Spirit showed up on any Sunday in any of our churches, in our homes, right, that we'd be in deep trouble, because there's a whole bunch of things that we like to think we don't struggle with or that we don't have a problem with that we have a problem with, right? So Jesus isn't interested in taking only part of your oppression away, right? Part of the things you struggle away with, right? He's interested in giving you freedom from it all, right? And so he doesn't necessarily The Holy Spirit, if we invite the Holy Spirit to come into a situation, he doesn't ask us, hey, do you want to keep this little part? Do you want to keep this? He's going to deal with it all. Mm-hmm. And so again, the fear comes in when we realize that, hey, God means business. He's going to deal with this stuff. Mm-hmm. We don't want to deal with things. So how do we avoid this? First of all, we need to understand the whole picture. If you're not interested in dealing with the enemy, with oppression, right? Because that's the real battle that Jesus is involved in, right? He's not really involved in just making your life happy or good or perfect. Like, that's not what he really wants. He fights the enemy, right? So he wants us to understand that. If he is going to work in your life, he's going to work in your life. Most of us don't really want that.
Mm. Absolutely. And then we see here, as a result of them pushing Jesus away, asking him to leave, we see that he gets into the boat and leaves. But we don't end on that sad note. Instead, we see the man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return home and tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. So unlike the people of the town who pushed Jesus away, they didn't want him to work in their lives. They didn't want him around them. We see that this man actually gets it, that he realizes his new life, his new opportunities, his relief from that oppression and possession. We see that he realizes that's all because of Jesus, and he wants to be with Jesus. He wants to be where Jesus is. He wants to go with him, but he's given a task. He can't just go and be with Jesus. He needs to actually take Jesus to other people. And don't we have that same task each day? We're supposed to take Jesus to other people.
Yeah, that's well said.
Any other last thoughts on that?
No, I think that's right. Really good, actually.
Fantastic. Well, we hope that you've been challenged by this and encouraged by it, and you'll join us next time as we continue on in Luke 8 on another episode of A Fresh Perspective here on Heavenward Thinking.